Start us smoothly. So, hello and welcome to this session on how to get started with Camel and Quarkus. My name is Alexandre Galis. I'm working for Red Hat as a senior software engineer, and I'm also a Camel contributor. In this session, what I would like to show you is the implementation of a typical Camel route. And what I mean by typical Camel route is a route where I will consume a message, apply an enterprise integration pattern, and finally produce a result. And we will do that, but in the context of Camel on Quarkus. So Quarkus, you know, this is this Kubernetes Java stack, which is tailored for Hotspot, OpenJDK Hotspot, and GraalVM. And during this session, we will have the opportunity to learn a few concepts. So first, we will have a look at the Quarkus extensions, and then the dev mode. The core of the presentation, we will implement the test and also explain what are the JVM and native modes. And finally, at the end of the demonstration, we will wrap up with finalizing the implementation of our typical Camel route. And we will also have a look at the very same route deployed on different runtimes, and then have a look at some key metrics which are interesting. Okay. In order to enjoy this presentation, it would be very good if you could put the presentation content. So you need to double click on it so in order to enlarge, because we will have a lot of commands, and so you would have a better experience this way. So without further ado, notice, let's start with the prerequisites. And here we will need Java. We will also need Maven. And finally, a tool which is called Native Image. So, and what we see, so I'm running Java version 11, Maven 3.6.3. By the way, Maven U, it's a command, it's my personal shortcut for Maven, so just replace with Maven and that's fine. And Native Image, which is the tool from GraalVM, and I'm running version 20.1 here. There are plenty of information on how to install the Native Image tool on the Quarkus website. So far, we have our prerequisites. So now, let's create a skeleton project. And we do this with this command, the Quarkus Maven plugin, in version 1.8.1 final, and we invoke the create goal. So let's see it in action. We are proposed with some options. We keep all the default for this demo so that it's more simple. And finally, we have a MyQuarkus project folder which has been created, and we dive into this project. So now we need to think a bit about the design of our routes. When we implement a typical Camel route, we will need to interact with some frameworks and technologies. And the way to do this with Quarkus is called extensions. So let's see what extensions we have at our disposal here with the Quarkus Maven plugin and invoking list extensions. And we see that Quarkus has the possibility to work with Apache Chica. We have a Quarkus extension for Spring DI, and also Smolry Reactive Messaging MQTT connector. And if we go a bit upper in the list, we will see that Quarkus has some other extensions, the Camel Quarkus extensions, and we have the possibility to work with Camel XSLT, Camel VM, Camel Twitter, and so on. So right now, we just need to cherry pick the extensions that we need. So let's do this with still the Quarkus plugin, but this time we will invoke add extensions and provide the list of extensions. So we will have a route consuming some HTTP requests, then apply an enterprise integration pattern on top of a JSON pass expression, and finally to have something graphical produce a PDF content. Well, our extensions have now been added. We have our skeleton routes enriched with some extensions. So right now, it's time for us to go and import this project in my IDE. On the bottom left of the screen, we see what? We see that we have a typical Maven layout, really standard. So right now, what we need, it's a way for Camel Quarkus at bootstrap time to load our routes. We could either implement an XML DSL route For that, we will need to create an XML file. But in this example, what we will do, we will use the Java DSL. And as such, we create a class. Let's call it my route builder. And we just make it extends from route builder. So we need to implement import the relevant packages. And now we have our configure method. So let's just here implement as usual our logic. We will do something very simple, some things like from platform http/hello. And then here we will set the body to a constant value with some things like hello, camel, Quarkus. Okay, fair enough for a first prototype. Right now I want to see this in action. And we will do this with the Quarkus dev plugin here. So I'm running it. What's happening is that Camel Quarkus at Bootstrap will detect that we have a class extending route builder. It will load the logic, provide some logs. And here we see that we have an HTTP engine which is listening on port 8080. So in the bottom shell, I will launch this command, watch HTTP. HTTP/hello. Every 2 seconds, it performs an HTTP request. And there we have a first view of our prototype. We have a message here. But well, the message is not really, really fine. Actually, we have some typo. This is okay. We are in prototype phase. So let's correct this. And I go here. Let's put an exclamation mark. And here, please be very attentive because things in Quarkus dev mode happens very fast. I save. The dev mode automatically reloaded the routes under the hood, and my result is available there directly. And this is the key takeaway from this session. We have the dev mode, which allows us to have a constant feedback loop with our development. Okay, but we would like to move to testing now. So let's create a class called myRouteBuilderTest this time. In Quarkus, we have this annotation at Quarkus test annotation. That will bootstrap Quarkus inside the context of a test. We could use then plain Jupyter test annotation and write a test logic, some things like get hello should succeed. Well, let's import the relevant packages, test JUnit. This is plain Jupyter API annotation. Right now, as we are testing a simple HTTP-based service, in Quarkus, we have a first-class support for REST Assured. So let's import this, import static IO, REST Assured dot REST Assured, and we will import the given method. Now we are able to write some things like given, get, slash hello. Then here, we expect a status code of, let's say, 200. Okay, it seems to compile. Now, let's see this in action with Maven clean tests. What will happen under the hood? We have this at Quarkus test annotation. It will bootstrap Quarkus. Our route will be loaded. Then REST Assured enters the game, and it will issue an HTTP request and get the status code, the return status code, and expect a status of 200. So here we see that our test has been run and the build is success. Okay, so right now, let's move to the next phase. We have tested, now we would like to build. We will do this with this command, maven package. And as such, we are triggering a build in what we call the JVM mode. So the test will be run, obviously. And now in the target folder, we should see the build output. And what we have in the target folder, we have a runner jar. So no fat jar here, simply a runner jar. And let's get in touch with this build output in JVM mode to see the size. We see here that the size of the runner jar is 300 kibibytes. But to be fair, if we build a container which runs this runner jar, we will need more. We will need what? We will need the target lib folder. And we will also need a part of Java. And I will say a good estimation would be the lib modules. And we end up with a bill of 174 millibytes. But well, okay, it could seem pretty conventional for a Java application. Okay, now let's start our runner jar. So we just do this way, target my Quarkus runner jar. And see here, it started in something like 1 second. Important to notice. In the bottom shell now, what I will do, I will perform this command, ps -o rsscmd, and as such, I show the RSS memory. So RSS stands for residence set size. To say it quickly, it is the amount of RAM used by your process. In this case, we could say this is just you have just enough of you have just the part of your shared memory, heap and stack, which are currently actually being used by your application. I mean being in RAM currently now. And we end up with a bill of 170 millibytes. Okay, fair enough. And this is it for the JVM mode. We may perhaps just launch the HTTP request and see the results here. Same output that in dev mode, obviously. So, well, okay, now we know a bit more the JVM mode. It would be very interesting to see this in the other mode, which is called the native mode. So we go back few steps back and with this command maven package, but now what we do, we activate the native profile. And as such, we are triggering a build in native mode. Honestly, this takes quite a while. So this is a good opportunity for me to show you some slides. And what do we see? Okay, well, let me show you the slides that way. So in JVM mode, what Quarkus is doing is optimizing the boot time and memory usage. And it does so by moving some typical framework initialization tasks from runtime to build time. When we think about it, we live in a world of container which has stopped and started more frequently than ever. So is it really interesting to do things like parsing a configuration file at build time? And the answer of Quarkus is no. And as such, we will end up doing things like finding annotated classes at build time, removing unused bits at build time, and so on. Next, the native mode. I would say this is the same spirit, but with a different technique. Using GraL VM static compilation tool. You remember in the prior quasit, this native IMH tool. And here, I would say we are going one step further in the compile time boot approach. For instance, you may execute Java static initializer at build time. Note that there is also a fine-grained dead code elimination, which is capable of removing unused methods and even unused fields across the whole Java stack. Finally, the choice was made to remove the JIT compiler, with a trade-off here, because on the one hand, you lose the dynamic optimization, but on the other hand, you save the cost of embedding this JIT compiler infrastructure inside your executable. So now a quick recap between JVM mode and native mode. I would say concerning the build and debug experience in JVM mode, this is pretty standard this is what current Java developers are used to. In native mode, this is different. The build is slow. We are currently experiencing this, and we will see how much time it has taken at the end. And the debugging is a bit harder because we are producing a native executable. And as such, we will need to use tools like GDB in order to debug. So this is not quite common for Java developers. Concerning the boot time and memory usage, in JVM mode, Quarkus is already doing fine. But in native mode, we go one step further. The boot time, we could qualify it of instant. And the memory usage is so tiny. A word concerning the throughput. The throughput in JVM mode is more based on runtime optimization. What I mean here is just you have the JIT compiler, so you have the dynamic optimization occurring given your execution profile. Concerning native mode, it's different, and I would say it's based on better density. What I would mean here, take this example of we could have a single container which is running in JVM mode, and for the same memory budget, and this is a key point, for the same memory budget, we may have multiple containers running in native mode. So this brings you some extra throughput, and this gives you also better than that on-demand throughput that you can activate when you want it, when you need it. Okay, let's wrap up with the use case. I would say the JVM mode is more oriented toward a single long running service, while the native mode will give its best for some shortening services. And now let's go back to our command line, and we see here that the build took some things like 3 minutes. Well, okay, but let's see what we have for this price. In the target folder, we now have another runner. It's no more a runner jar, it's a runner executable. So same treatment, let's look at the size. And here, so this size with du, so this size, total this size is 54 MB. It could seem quite large for an executable, but actually, just think about what we have embedded there. We have just enough of our application, we have just enough of our third-party libraries, and we enough has just enough of the JDK which is there. And for that, we also have a snapshot of the application startup memory. So actually, it's not that big, and it's to be compared with the 170 MB we had as an all-inclusive disk size cost. Okay, now, if this is an executable, we should be able to start it that way. Well, it starts, and it starts quickly. Let's see here. We have been able to start in something like 30 milliseconds. This is the order of magnitude when you are talking with tools built with native image, tens of milliseconds for startup time. Okay, in the bottom window, I will have a look at the RSS memory. So the very same commands than previously in JVM mode, and we end up with a bill of 46 MB, which is tiny for a Java application. Okay, last, perhaps we will invoke an HTTP request and see that we have the same result. So let's sum it up. What we have seen that in Quarkus, we have two modes, JVM and native. And they offer the same kind of behavior, actually, but they differ from the performance profile. So this is for distinct scenarios, distinct usage. Okay. Now let's go back to the implementation of our typical camel route that we left there. Okay, so what we have here, we create a content, we create a message, but the value is hard-coded. It would be interesting to have something more dynamic and maybe something which will come from a Quarkus property. We could do this that way. We define a key which is emergy. So this is MSG is a config property. And in Quarkus, a way to set the property is from the application.properties file. We could do something like message, like it's warm. I don't know. Something like that with a plenty of typo. You will see that we will correct that later on. And let's run this so we can go back with Quarkus dev. I will prepare the HTTP request in the bottom. So what's happening? Everything is started, and in the bottom window, I issue my command, and I see that the message produced is now it's warm or something which is not really readable. But at least it comes from the Quarkus config property. Right now, what we will do, we go back in the command line, and we will override this value from the command line. So this time, we will have some things more clear. It's warm. Okay, not really accurate because we are starting the fall season, but let's do that way. It's warm. And in so the route is starting. In the bottom shell, I prepare the command and I have it's warm as a result. Okay, so now our value is dynamic. It's coming from an environment, from a property. Well. So what could we do else? Yeah, here we are just, so our typical camel route, we need to consume a message, apply an enterprise integration pattern. So let's do this. And for that, we will see that we have a JSON body as an incoming HTTP request with a JSON content. So we will have something like a room with a temperature. And let's say the temperature may be something like 40. So now what we would like to do, we would like to, given the temperature, issue a different body. So this is the content-based router that Justin presented us. I will redo the same kind of thing. So we do choice when the given JSON pass expression is true. So some things like dollar room where at that temperature would be greater than the given threshold, let's say 30. As such, I am ready. We set the body to a value coming from a Quarkus property, and otherwise, we will set the body, but this time to an hard-coded value. So back to an hard-coded value. The hard-coded value will be conversely, it's called. And here, typical KML construct in Java DSL, we end to close the choice. So maybe not all of us are familiar with this, the KML syntax, the KML language. So I sum it up. Here, we are consuming some HTTP requests from the underlying platform HTTP server and slash hello. The content will be a JSON input. Then, given the temperature, we will extract the temperature. And when the temperature is greater than a given threshold, we will issue a message coming from the command line, it's warm. And otherwise, we will issue a message hard-coded there, it's cold. So let's see this in action. Still, we are on Maven Quarkus Dev. We prepare. Okay, yeah, so right now, I will need to inject JSON payload. So the same command, but this time with the JSON payload, which is not fine. Okay, I need to move that because I have something in front which prevented me to do. Okay, that way. So now we have a message issued, it's warm. And if we change the temperature, we narrow down to 10, we are issuing it's cold. So far, so good. Finally, last step, we have consumed the message, apply an enterprise integration pattern. Let's produce a result. And we said that this is a graphical demo, so we would like to produce a PDF document with, for instance, a font size of, let's say, 2026, why not? And reproduce the same command. Now we have some binary data which are issued, good sign, but then we will flush them in a file.pdf and then open that with Firefox. For visualization, yeah, it's there, it's called, we have our message, so now this is a PDF document. And I will do the same by raising up the temperature to something like 60 and reopen the file in Firefox, and I have another file with the content it's formed as a PDF document. Well, so sum up from this part, with KML and Quarkus, we're able to use the typical KML construct. So this is the typical and not changing standard. But as we are on top of Quarkus, we have some more features more. Here we have been able to use Quarkus config property, and there are more of that kind of feature on top of Quarkus. Okay, so now we have implemented our typical KML route. We could say mission complete, but no. We would like to compare this very same route on top of different runtime. For this, we move the build upper in this KML Hello project. What do we have in this project? We have the very same demo that we have just built, the typical KML route, but this time on top of KML Quarkus JVM mod, on top of KML Quarkus native mod, and also, sorry, on top of KML Spring Boot. And there is this script compare.sh. So let's run it. And what this script will do, it will perform some interesting metrics. And the first interesting metric is the time it takes to serve the first request. So the scenario is that you have an incoming request. Your framework is not booted, so you boot your framework. You take the JSON body. You proceed with the KML route. And then you send back the PDF document. And with that, we have an estimation of the time to serve the first request. This is what we will find in this first column. Boot plus first response delay. The disk size and residence set size, I've already mentioned that during the presentation, so I think now we know what it is. Let's go back to the interpretation of this table. So with the runtime on Spring Boot, we see that we are able to serve the first request in some things like 4 or 5 seconds. In Quarkus JVM, we are doing, let's say, 2 or 3 times faster. And in Quarkus Native, this is, some things like, I don't know, 20 times faster, maybe some things like that, but not the same order of magnitude, actually. Concerning the disk size, interesting to see that in Spring Boot and Quarkus JVM, we have almost the same size. But when we think about it, it makes sense because we need to embed Java, and this is what takes the most size. While in Quarkus JVM, in Quarkus Native, sorry, we have this fine-grained dead code elimination, and we end up with some things like 55 millibast of disk size. Finally, very important, the memory budget. It costs so much now that in Spring Boot, for a single container which will be running on KML Spring Boot, we may be able to run, let's say, somehow 2 in KML Quarkus JVM and maybe 6 or 7 in Quarkus Native. So I find this table very illustrative. And here I would say the lesson is that if you come to think of performance in terms of what is important is the first time, the time to serve the first request, and also the memory budget to cost lower, for instance, I think it could be a good sign that you're interested, you should take interest for Camel on Quarkus. Yeah, I think we are reaching the end of this demonstration. Yeah, so what do we have? Okay, I've implemented this route locally on my machine and deployed locally on my machine. I invite you to stay for the next session because if I remember well, Omar will present the same kind of things, but deploy with continuous delivery and also on top of Knative. Right now, I hope you have a better idea of why we have created Camel Quarkus. In a few words, I would say it's all about lightweight pattern-based integration running in the cloud. I mean, if you have that, this is the main purpose. And I already pasted you the tiny URL to have some interesting links. At this stage, I will say thanks for attending. We should have few minutes for questions, I think. But in any case, feel free to reach out to the Camel community. We really love contribution. It's not only about code, you know, it's bugs, ideas, docs, and we really like to work in a very constructive way. Thank you.
Awesome, Alex. Thank you for that inspiring live coding demo. It was really action-packed throughout. Yeah. So, Klaus been answering the questions in the chat, but perhaps you have some insights that you can also help us with here. So Bob was asking, is there any formal training for Apache Camel on Quarkus that you know of? Anyone giving, you know, like lectures and then perhaps some certifications after that?
Honestly, no, I don't think it exists, or maybe I'm not aware of.
Yeah, Klaus was answering the same thing. So we have a bunch of articles on the website, so you can browse through those, and Klaus shared a link to, you know, where any such trainings, there's a training page on the website, so if any training should arise, we'll put it up there. Gerald was asking, does the same approach work for Blueprint DSL? So Klaus also answered this one, but perhaps you can expand on that.
Yeah, with Blueprint, so no, I don't think. I don't know what to explain actually. No, I don't think it's working because Quarkus, we are implementing Quarkus just for Camel with Java DSL and XML DSL. So yeah.
Klaus is basically saying no to Blueprint DSL. But yes to the XML DSL, which is basically the same thing. You miss some of the features in there, but yeah, you get a lot of the benefits from being lightweight and super fast. Awesome, Alex. So you were probably 10 minutes ahead of schedule, but that's awesome. We can end here and let people... Yeah, you've been really, really fast. We can let people have a break, and then in 10 minutes, we have a next session and how to build and deploy cloud-native Camel Quarkus routes with Tecton and Knative. So that should be also really, really interesting. Cool. Thank you all for attending, and see you in a couple of minutes.
Many thanks, Guy. Bye.